Hi everyone, David Packer here, and in this video I would like to discuss the weather. Now I don't mean I want to discuss whether it will be cloudy, cold or sunny this week in Pittsburgh. What I want to discuss is why do planets have weather. Let us begin by writing down a list of weather related questions and then outline how we're going to proceed to answer these questions. Why is it, when we look at Jupiter, it appears so stripy? Right here is a picture of Jupiter taken by the Juno spacecraft, and the colors on this picture have been later enhanced by the Stania O. Now, the enhanced colors let us see the details better. The first interesting detail you might have noticed in this picture is a little black dot that the teal arrow points to. What is this dot? Is this damage to the camera? Well, no, this is the shadow of one of Jupiter's moons. So in this picture, there is a part of Jupiter that is experiencing a lunar eclipse. Now that we got the black dot out of the way, the really prominent feature on this picture are these bands that we see in Jupiter's atmosphere, pointed to by the pink arrows. What are these bands? How do we understand where they come from? Our goal is that by the end of this lecture, we will understand where these bands come from, and also why there are swirls in between the bands. Now, the weather on Jupiter is an extreme, but the same reason why there is weather on Jupiter, there is also weather on Earth, so we want to understand that question as well, as it pertains to our daily lives quite a lot more. And here is a picture of Earth weather from space. This is taken by GOES, Geostationary Operational Environmental Satellite 17, which is jointly operated by NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and NASA. This satellite is used to track weather on Earth and help to make weather predictions. Now, of course, the crucial question is not just what is the origin of weather, but also how do we make predictions about the weather in the future. And this question we want to break down into two parts. How do we predict the weather, that is the short-term forecast, and how do we predict the climate, or the long-term forecast over many years? Now that we have our questions, let's go ahead and come up with an outline how we're going to address them. We will begin by addressing the origin of weather, and that will be the goal of this video. Specifically, we will look at three things. Differential heating, that is why the equator is so much warmer than the poles of the Earth. Next, we will look at global air circulation and the Coriolis force, which causes air movement all around the planet. And finally, we will discuss chaotic dynamics, also known as the butterfly effect. And this will answer the question, why don't we just set up a steady state flow? Why does the weather change from day to day and week to week? In the next video, we will discuss weather and climate modeling. This is a topic which is very close to my heart because my mom is a space meteorologist. She works on weather modeling at the Center for Space Research at the University of Texas at Austin. And finally, we are going to discuss satellite meteorology, that is how satellites are used to monitor weather, what kind of things can we observe from satellites, and how do we use this data to build models of weather and make better predictions about weather in the future. We begin by discussing what is differential heating. Have you ever wondered why the weather is so much warmer in the tropics near the equator as compared in the northern and southern regions near the Earth's north and south pole? Is it because the tropics, the equator, is closer to the sun? Well, that can't possibly be. That can't possibly be the reason. The Earth's equator is only 0.004% closer to the sun than the poles. Both the poles and the equator receive approximately the same amount of light. But how is it distributed? Well, let's go ahead and draw the Earth. So here is the equator and the north and south poles of the Earth. Next, let us draw the rays of sunlight which are shining down onto the Earth. So these parallel lines represent the rays of sunlight, and what you notice is the lines are essentially parallel because the sun is so far away from the Earth as compared to the Earth's diameter. Now, how much light is there between each set of parallel lines? That is, how much light is represented by each orange arrow? Each channel, outlined by the red-orange lines, carries the same amount of light. And that is because the channels are essentially parallel. Now let's go ahead and take a look at how this sunlight falls onto the Earth. Near the equator, one channel falls onto this red outlined region, while near the north pole of the Earth, a single channel covers a much larger region of the Earth. Now, in both cases, near the equator and near the pole, the amount of sunlight deposited into the outlined patch is the same, but the size of the patches are different, and therefore the amount of sunlight per unit area that falls onto the Earth is different. Patches of the Earth near the equator are smaller, and therefore they receive more sunlight per unit area. On the other hand, the patches near the poles are larger, and therefore they receive less sunlight per unit area. Now, how does this look from the perspective of an observer on Earth? Well, the sun is higher in the sky near the equator than near the poles. So let's go ahead and draw what an observer on Earth sees. Near the equator at noon, the sun appears essentially overhead, depending slightly on the time of year. Now, what happens for observer near a pole? Well, near the pole, even at the highest point in the day, the sun is not very high up in the sky. The sun is always shining down at an oblique angle. Now, this geometrical reason, the obliqueness of the sun and the size of the patch that it shines on, is exactly the reason why the sun is hotter at noon than at sunrise or sunset, and also near the equator as compared to near the poles. In summary, differential heating states that the Earth gets heated more near the equator than it does at the poles. Now, how does this differential heating drive Earth weather? Well, let's go ahead and take a look. To make this more relatable and easier to draw, instead of looking at global convection and circulation, let's look at a model of it. So for a model, imagine that we have a petri dish or some other kind of cylindrical dish, which is pretty shallow and it is filled with some sort of fluid like water. Now, in order to simulate differential heating, under the disk we're going to place some elements. In the middle, we're going to place a cold element, for example, a little pack of ice. The ice pack simulates the lack of heating by the sun near the north pole of the Earth. Now, what do we do with the outer edges of the disk? Well, on the outside rim of the disk, outside bottom rim of the disk, that is supposed to be the equator, and we're going to heat that up. Now, how is this differential heating, that is, heating at the edges and cooling in the middle, going to drive fluid motion inside our fluid-filled disk? The differential heating of the disk is going to drive the formation of convection cells, in which the fluid circulates round and round. Now, how exactly does a convection cell form? The heating fluid near the edges causes a warmer fluid to rise up. Now, cold fluid from the bottom of the disk rushes in to fill the empty space, causing an outward flow along the bottom of the disk. Now, warm fluid at the top moves towards the center as it's being pushed around and around. And finally, the fluid as it reaches the center at the top cools down and falls down. In order to make it easier to draw the picture, I drew just one slice of the convection cell. In reality, everywhere in the fluid-filled disk, towards the middle of the disk, the fluid is sinking, flowing down. towards the bottom of the disk. The fluid is flowing outwards. Towards the top part of the disk, the fluid is flowing inwards. And around the outer edges of the disk, the fluid is flowing upwards. So far, our model of global circulation is missing a very important component, and that is that the Earth rotates on its axis, and that results in a profound change of how circulation works. Now, in order to take our model of global convection and make it a model of global circulation, what we need to do is go ahead and take our dish and spin it round and round on its axis. But before we go ahead and look at what that does, let's first consider what we expect to happen. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw the rotating dish at various time points. The four pictures at the top indicate four different snapshots of what the disk looks like in the laboratory frame. The picture in the bottom is going to be the picture of the disk or of the dish in the dish fixed frame, that is, in the rotating frame. Now the pictures in the top row are in the lab frame at different times, so let me go ahead and adjust how much they're tilted to indicate that the dish is rotating. The pink lines are drawn in order to be able to see how far the dish has rotated. And now I'm just messing to make sure all the images of the dish are of the same size. Here we go. Next, I draw a straight purple line in order to be able to reference how far the dish has rotated. So here we go, copy the purple line a couple times over, and then draw the rotation angles. Now imagine that I take a ball bearing, put it in the middle of the dish, and fling it outwards towards the top. Now in the lab frame, the ball bearing just moves straight up. So here it is in the second snapshot, third snapshot, and fourth snapshot, moving along the straight purple line. Now how does the motion of the ball bearing appear in the dish fixed coordinates? Well, in the first snapshot, the ball bearing is right in the middle. In this next snapshot, we see that the ball bearing has deviated a little bit from the pink guidance lines. So here we go, we draw the ball bearing slightly deviated. In the third snapshot, it's deviated even more. And therefore, in the dish fixed coordinates, we see that the ball bearing is curving away. Going to the fourth snapshot, we see even larger deviation away from the pink guidance lines. And therefore, in the fixed dish coordinates, the final snapshot appears even more curved away. Drawing a smooth lines through the points in the dish fixed coordinates, we see that the smooth line appears as a curve. To summarize, in the lab fixed coordinates, the ball bearing moves on a straight line. However, in the dish fixed coordinates, the ball bearing appears to be moving on a curved line. It is as if there is a force acting on the ball bearing. This is called the Coriolis force. However, just like the centripetal force, the Coriolis force is not a real force. And we know this because in the lab fixed coordinates, the ball bearing moves on a straight line, as it's supposed to according to Newton's first law. Instead, what's happening is that we are looking at the ball bearing in a coordinate system that is accelerating. The acceleration has to do with the steady spinning of the dish. And therefore, straight line motion, which follows Newton's first law in the lab fixed frame, when transformed to the rotating frame that is fixed to the spinning dish, becomes curved motion, as if there is a fictitious force acting on our ball bearing. Because of this fictitious nature of the Coriolis force, many authors refer to it not as a force, but rather as the Coriolis effect. Now, to get a better appreciation for how the Coriolis force or effect work, let's go ahead and take a look at some more projectile motion. To get our bearings straight, let me first draw a diagram of the Earth looking down from the North Pole. Now the Earth spins eastward, or in this representation, it's spinning counterclockwise. And when we take a look at United States, this eastward spinning of the Earth is precisely why the sun rises in Boston and sets over in Los Angeles. Now suppose that we construct a really tall tower somewhere near the equator of the Earth. In this picture of the tower, eastwards is to the left and westwards is to the right. Next, let's do the Galileo-like experiment and take a cannonball and drop it off the top of the tower. Now, where do we expect the projectile to fall? Will it fall straight down? Will it deflect east? Or will it deflect west? So while you guys consider the choices, let's reiterate them again. After the ball is dropped from the tower, will it fall straight down? Will it deflect eastwards? Or will it deflect westwards? And how do we decide? Well, both the top and bottom of the tower are moving eastwards, but the top is moving faster because it's further away from the center of the Earth. And we can clearly see this by drawing the tower on top of the Earth and seeing how much the top and the bottom move in a given time slice. So here is our time slice, and we see that the bottom doesn't move quite as much as the top. Now what does this mean? This means that as the ball falls down, it will deflect eastwards as it's moving to the east faster than the bottom of the tower is. Now let's consider another situation in which the Coriolis effect is important. And that is of shooting cannons. Suppose we want to take a cannon and shoot at this castle over here. And to give our problem bearings, let's suppose that we are shooting the cannon towards the north, so east direction is to the right and west is to the left. Now further, suppose that we aim the cannon straight at the castle. Now the question becomes, will the cannonball hit the castle or will it miss? To answer this question, let's take a look at what's happening. Both the castle and the cannon are moving to the east. But because the cannon is further south than the castle, the cannon is moving faster. So during the time of the flight of the cannon gets displaced to the east more than the castle does. Now, as the cannon fires a cannonball, it has two components to its velocity. The component directed towards the castle, because of the cannon projecting the cannonball out, as well as another component in the direction of the rotation of the Earth. As a cannonball flies out of the cannon, it flies in a straight line and misses the castle. Why does the cannonball miss the castle? Well, that's because the castle is moving eastwards slower than the cannon, and hence the cannonball, and therefore the cannonball overshoots to the east or to the right. Now let's go ahead and redraw the same picture, but now not from a fixed perspective, but from perspective of an observer that is stationary on the surface of the Earth. So here's my castle and here's my cannon. And which way does the cannonball fly? It doesn't fly straight, it veers off to the right. To summarize, from the point of view of the gun, the cannonball doesn't fly straight, it veers off to the east when firing northwards in the northern hemisphere. And this indeed has to be taken into account when constructing ballistic tables for the gun. Now, while the Coriolis effect is not very large for regular size guns, for big guns it is really quite important. To give you just an idea of how important it is, here is the so-called Paris gun, which was used by the Germans during World War I to shoot at Paris. Let's take a look at the map of Europe. The gun was emplaced at Crepy-en-Laon, and it was shot at Paris 120 kilometers away. Over the flight path of the projectile was deflected by about 600 meters due to the Coriolis effect. In other words, the amount of deflection as compared to the flight path length was about 0.5%. It turns out that the Coriolis effect in projectile motion was first described in 1651 by Riccioli and Grimaldi. It was revisited in 1674 by Decollet. Both the 1651 and the 1674 work predicted that there should be a Coriolis force or Coriolis effect, but neither work was able to observe it. Therefore, they argued that the Earth does not spin, which was a requirement of Copernican theory, and therefore Copernicus must be wrong, and the Earth, stationary, must be at the center of the universe, and the Sun and the other planets must be spinning around it. Of course, this is a brilliant example of where the theory was right, but the interpretation of the experimental evidence was wrong. The problem was, of course, that in the 1600s, the authors did not have sufficiently precise instruments to detect the Coriolis force. Now let's go ahead and take our model of global convection and improve it by adding the Coriolis effect to it to make a model of global circulation. We now go ahead, take our dish and spin it up. Now consider the fluid moving either inwards towards the center or outwards towards the edges. Because of the Coriolis effect, the fluid no longer moves in a straight line, but curves away. This causes the fluid to swirl, resulting in the formation of miniature hurricanes and cyclones. As we have already stated, the Coriolis effect deflects the fluid as it moves either towards the center or away from the center of the dish. This causes the fluid to swirl. In this example, we have the dish set up to rotate in the same direction as the northern hemisphere, and therefore the swirling is counterclockwise, just like cyclones and hurricanes in the northern hemisphere of the Earth. In the southern hemisphere, the Coriolis effect goes in the other direction, and therefore cyclones and typhoons, as hurricanes are called in the southern hemisphere, swirl clockwise as opposed to counterclockwise. Now, in order to see how this effects work on the global scale of the Earth, requires more 3D graphics than what I can manage. And therefore, I strongly encourage you to watch the videos from the UK Meteorological Office showing you how this works. I would also encourage you to watch the lab demo video produced by MIT, which shows how in a rotating dish, differential heating results in the formation of convection and also of swirling of fluid. The links to both the Meteorological Office videos as well as the MIT demo video will be listed below this video. In the next video, we will discuss how chaos, in addition to global circulation, results in the formation of weather, and specifically why the weather is not always the same, why do we sometimes have stormy weather and sometimes we have calm weather. As always, thank you for watching and remember to stay curious.